Thanks, PM. Well, this plan is a practically achievable pathway for Australia to reach net zero by 2050, the Australian way. And that means supporting our traditional jobs, but also capturing new opportunities. It means recognising that customer and investor demands are changing, and we need to adapt with them. It means preserving our traditional advantage in competitive, reliable, affordable energy. But it also means building on our track record. And if we turn to the first slide, you'll see that Australia's track record is a proud one. We see developing countries that since 2005 have increased emissions by up to 86% in India, over 70% in China, 33% in South Korea. And Australia versus even developed countries has performed extremely well with a reduction of almost 21% since 2005, 20.8%. That's higher than the OECD average in terms of reductions. The United States, Japan, New Zealand and Canada that are obviously comparable major commodity exporters like Australia. Now, we've achieved that at a time when we've increased our economy by 45% and we've increased our product exports by over 200%. And you'll see on the next slide that reduction of 20.8%, of course, is substantially larger if you exclude that extraordinary export performance, which all Australians can be very proud of. Part of that is the rapid growth of the LNG sector, where Australia has been a world leader. If we look forward to 2030, we are on track to meet and beat our Paris targets. As the Prime Minister said, we're on track now with the work we've done in the technology investment roadmap to achieve up to 35% reduction by 2030. And that comes on a per capita basis to a reduction in emissions of 50% or more, which is a very, very respectable performance. And as always with Australia, we achieve, we deliver. That has been our track record. When we say we're going to do something, we do it, we meet it, and we beat it. Now, if we look forward to our plan to 2050, if we go to the next slide, the vision here is to take practical action to achieve net zero by 2050. And that plan is built on our existing policies. It's a plan that will not put industries, regions, or jobs at risk. It means we take advantage of those economic opportunities that are emerging now while continuing to serve our traditional markets. And it's a plan for net zero, not absolute zero. And that means offsets are an important part of that plan. The recognition, for instance, that Australia has 90 million hectares of productive agricultural land, which is a very significant carbon sink and can be a more significant carbon sink. There are five principles driving the plan. Technology, not taxes. Choices, not mandates. We respect customer choice. We respect the choices of Australians, and they've made the choices. We've seen a dramatic uptake of household solar, for instance, in Australia, world-leading stuff. But we also respect the choices of our export customers. Those choices will change over time, but it's not for us to say to them what they should buy. It's for us to serve them and adapt our products as they ask for those products to change. It means driving down the costs of a portfolio of technologies, getting those low emissions technologies to cost competitiveness. This is a plan about reducing the cost of low emissions technologies, not raising the cost of traditional energy sources. And in sync with that, the fourth principle is to keep our affordable, reliable energy advantage that we've had as a nation for many, many years, and our technology goals are all about supporting that. We are, as a country, accountable for progress, and there is no country that has provided quarterly emissions updates by sector, by gas, over an extended period of time as Australia has, and that transparency will continue. If you look at where the plan delivers the reductions in emissions, we've already achieved over 20%, as I said. The technology investment roadmap, the priority technologies in that roadmap that I outlined with some additions I'll come to in a moment, back in September last year, will drive down emissions by 40 8%. Global technology trends, this is technologies where we're not shaping them, but we will use them, drive down emissions by another 15%. Offsets provide the opportunity to further reduce emissions by 10 to 20%. And then we're relying on additional technology breakthroughs, some of which we can see now, that are likely to provide that final 15%. If you compare our approach with other approaches to this, the traditional approach is to set a target, to model the carbon tax required to meet that target, and then impose a mechanism, usually with a 3 or 4 letter acronym, to impose that cost on all Australians. That's about raising the cost of traditional energy sources and traditional technologies. Our approach is quite different. We're looking at the customer and technology trends, shaping those trends to our advantage, and on the back of that, ensuring we have a portfolio of technologies that can deliver the outcome we want to deliver, which is net zero by 2050. Now, this is not new for Australians or for people all over the world. The march of technology is an extraordinary one, and it has solved problem after problem for us over an extended period of time. If you move to the next slide, you'll see some wonderful illustrations. If you look at the cost of transistors over time, we've seen dramatic reductions over decade after decade. And as a result, once those costs get to a certain point, you see explosive growth, non-linear, explosive growth of the technology. We've seen exactly that same pattern with solar. Solar costs have consistently, since the early 70s, come down at 12% or more a year. Every year, year on year, we've seen them coming down, coming down, coming down. For that first 30 years, from the early 70s to the early 2000s, 1 gigawatt was adopted. The next 10 years, we saw 100 gigawatts. The last 10 years, through to 2022, we're expecting to see 1,000 gigawatts. So that's how low emissions technologies advance. We're seeing similar reductions in costs in other technologies. And one example of which we've is obviously a priority technology in the technology investment roadmap is clean hydrogen, where we've set a goal of under $2 per kilogram. And as we get to that cost competitiveness, that roadmap goal, we know we'll see explosive growth in the deployment of clean hydrogen. We, as Australia, have an opportunity to be a world leader in the adoption of blue and green hydrogen. Now, the core levers in the plan are investment in that portfolio of technologies. And if we go to the next page, you'll see, in addition to that, we're providing incentives, not penalties, through the emission reduction mechanism that we set up a number of years ago, but we're also seeing rapid growth in private demand for credits, for abatement credits. And with that, we see great potential for the use of offsets, whether it's in soil carbon, land sequestration, carbon capture and storage, and high integrity offsets with our neighbours here in the Asia Pacific. Enabling that investment in infrastructure, information and standards on that information to inform customer choice and regular reviews that the PM has talked about. I'll skip over the next slide, which takes that into further detail, but that's in your plan. But central to this is the $20 billion investment the government is making in that technology portfolio. We are confident that that will deliver an additional $60 to $100 billion of state, government and private sector investment in research, deployment and demonstration and commercialisation. At the heart of the plan is getting to the goals in our technology investment roadmap. And if we move to the next page, you'll see those goals: getting the cost of hydrogen under $2 a kilogram, energy storage to under long duration energy storage to under $100 a megawatt hour, steel, aluminium, carbon capture and storage, soil carbon. We have added for this year an additional technology goal, which is ultra low cost solar below $15 per megawatt hour. This is a technology where Australia has played a leadership role for many, many years. We can continue to into the future, and that goal will be crucial not only to Australia meeting its goals, our goals, but for other countries around the world. By applying those technologies across various sectors, we can see how emissions will come down through choice, through customers choosing those technologies. And you see on the next page that the various technologies I've just outlined across different sectors, electricity, transport, industry, agriculture and the land sector, drives down emissions between now and 2050 based on the goals and the timeframes in that previous slide. And that puts Australia in a position to lead and shape not just our own emissions reduction, but emissions reductions for others and our customers around the world, and at the same time strengthen our economy. This is the right plan for Australia. To summarise the outcomes from it that you'll see in the plan, Australians $2,000 better off on average in 2050 compared with no Australian action. A gross national income, which is 1.6% higher. 62,000 new regional jobs in mining and heavy industry, and additional jobs over and above that in other sectors. No taxes or legislated targets or mechanisms. We won't be raising the price of electricity. Indeed, those technology goals put downward pressure on, and we certainly won't be putting industries, regions or jobs at risk.